Throughout my expeditions, I visited many beautiful places, but none struck me as much as this faraway tropical island. It was full of monkeys that were constantly arguing about which fruit is the best. I noticed three distinct groups among them, each one with a different opinion on the matter. There was a group that really liked avocado, banana was their second choice, and they disliked coconuts.
Avocado's the best.
The second group was fond of bananas, coconut was their second choice, and avocado was the third.
No, banana is better.
Finally, there was a group that loved coconuts, avocado was their second choice, and banana the last one.
Team coconut!
Quiet, quiet. Why don't we resolve your disagreement with a vote?
Yes, why don't we vote? But how do we do it? Help us, big monkey!
Charmed by their antics, I decided to help organize a vote. After all, there's just a few of them, so it can't be that hard, right? Okay, let's try something simple. Everyone will vote for exactly one fruit. Who votes for avocado? Okay, I see four votes. Banana? Two votes. And coconut? Three votes. Okay, avocado won. You're welcome.
But what about the second round?
Okay, I guess a two-round election is fairer, because now the banana fans can also express their opinion on the remaining two fruits. So, avocado and coconut go to the second round, and now, who votes for avocado? Still four votes. And coconut? Five votes. That's interesting. So if we use the two-round system, the coconut wins instead of the avocado, because it got the votes of the banana lovers in the second round. The preferences of the monkeys didn't change, but the winner did, because we used a different voting system. But then it got worse.
We protest!
Why?
We made a mistake in the first round. Can we run this two-round election one more time? Please?
Okay, let's do it one more time. First round, who is for avocado? Really, zero votes. Banana, six votes. And coconut, three votes. Interesting, now banana and coconut go to the second round. Who votes for banana in the second round? Still six votes, and still three votes for the coconut. So, banana won. But I'm pretty sure that some monkey business is at play here. These four monkeys really don't like coconut. They realize that their actual favorite, avocado, can't win against coconut in the second round, so they chose to vote for their second favorite, banana. The fact that the monkeys can change the outcome of the election by voting strategically is really annoying. An election is supposed to be a way of finding common ground, not a strategic game between voters. Wouldn't it be great to have a voting system where it always pays off to be truthful? And does such a system even exist? Unfortunately, the answer is no, and I'll now explain why. I'll prove to you the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem, which says that any reasonable voting system sometimes incentivizes strategic voting. I think the most challenging aspect of the theorem is to just understand what it's actually saying, so let's try to slowly unpack this sentence. First, we need to define what a voting system is. So imagine that each voter has some ranking of the candidates. The voter then writes this ranking on the ballot, and all these ballots are the input to the voting system. The voting system is then simply a function that gets this input and outputs the elected winner. To understand this definition, let's see how the two-round system works when we think about it this way. We first look at the top candidate of each voter, and elect the two candidates that go to the second round, which is the avocado and the coconut in this case. Then for each voter, we look at their preferred choice out of these two, and because coconut is preferred by more than half of the voters, it gets elected. To cover every possible input, we also need to specify what to do in the case of a tie. Let's say that to break ties, the two-round system prefers avocado to banana to coconut. So the two-round system is one example of what we mean by a voting system. Next, what do we mean by incentivizing strategic voting? Here's an example. Let's look at this scenario and this voter in particular. So far, we didn't distinguish between the true preference of each voter and the ranking that the voter actually writes on the ballot. But now let's imagine that all other voters already cast their ballots and our voter sees what's written on them. Now it's time for our voter to decide what ranking to put on the ballot. The voter can of course use their true preference. With the two-round system, the coconut would win now. But what if the voter votes strategically and writes this different ranking on the ballot? In this case, the two-round system actually elects the avocado as the winner. And what's important, our voter actually prefers the avocado to the coconut, so it paid off to lie about their preferences. Whenever this happens, we say that the voter is incentivized to vote strategically. Finally, why is there the word reasonable? Well, the problem is, think of the dictatorship voting system, and yes, that's an actual technical term, where the winner is always the top preference of voter number 3. That is, it's always the fruit in the orange square. This actually fits our definition of a voting system, but obviously there is no scenario in which strategic voting helps anybody. Unless you're the dictator, no one cares about your vote anyway. This is why we can prove the theorem only for voting systems that are, in some sense, reasonable. But how do we define that? Let's use the following definition. A voting system is reasonable if, whenever there is a candidate that's the first choice for the majority of the voters, then this candidate should win. For example, in this case, when the banana is the top preference of 5 voters, it has to be elected as the winner. The definition is satisfied by both the plurality voting system, which is the name for the one-round election that we used at the beginning, and the two-round system. So the definition seems to make sense, and since we now understand the theorem, let's prove it. Let's start by looking at the specific scenario from our story and trying to understand why it was so hard to choose the best fruit. Why is it that there were always so many monkeys that were unhappy about the result? Well, if you look at the rankings of the monkeys, you can see that there is some kind of cycle here. Some monkeys prefer avocado to banana to coconut, some prefer banana to coconut to avocado, and even others prefer coconut to avocado to banana. And here's the absolutely bonkers thing that's happening here. If you look at how many monkeys prefer avocado to banana, it's 7-2. If you look at how many prefer banana to coconut, it's 6-3. And if you now look at how many prefer coconut to avocado, it's 5-4. That means that whatever fruit ends up being elected, there's always some other candidate that would beat it in a head-to-head election. The fact that this can happen is called the Condorcet paradox. We'll use the term Condorcet cycle for any scenario with cyclic preferences that leads to this paradox. Ultimately, the Condorcet paradox is the reason why voting is straightforward with two candidates, but becomes very tricky if you have 3 or more. Remember, our goal is to demonstrate that for any reasonable voting system, there exists a scenario where a certain voter has an incentive to vote strategically. It turns out that any Condorcet cycle is almost, but not quite, such a scenario. Let me explain. Let's consider an arbitrary reasonable voting system. This system needs to elect some winner in this Condorcet cycle. Without loss of generality, let's say that it elects the coconut. But now let's look at this group of voters for whom the coconut is the bottom choice. Intuitively, these voters have the biggest incentive to try some kind of strategic voting because they're the most unhappy with the result. What if all these voters simultaneously cast a ballot that swaps avocado and banana? Now, a majority of voters have the banana as their first choice. But wait a minute, our definition of a reasonable voting system says that in this case, the banana has to be the winner. So if all these voters coordinate and they vote strategically, it pays off. The unhappy group now manage to elect their second choice, the banana, instead of their last, the coconut. The argument we just made is general. For any Condorcet cycle and any reasonable voting system, we can always find an unhappy group that can change the outcome if it cooperates. We're already very close to proving the theorem. The only problem is that we want to find a scenario where even a single voter can influence the result by voting strategically. Right now, that's not necessarily the case. We only argued that if the whole group coordinates, they change the result. Here's the idea needed to finish the proof. Start with our Condorcet cycle and imagine all these intermediate scenarios where each time just one voter flips the avocado with the banana. For now, forget about strategic voting and just think about all these scenarios simply as inputs to the voting system. We already assumed, without loss of generality, that the voting system elects the coconut in the first scenario, and we know that it elects the banana in the last one. We don't really know who the winner is in these intermediate situations. After all, we're considering an arbitrary voting system in our proof, but because the winner in the first scenario is different than in the last one, we know that it has to change at some point. So let's have a look at the point where the winner changes for the first time from the coconut to some other candidate. The only difference between these two scenarios is the ballot of this voter. Other than that, they're the same. But look, what if the ballot in the top scenario shows the honest preference of that voter? Notice that the elected winner is the coconut, which is the worst option for the voter. The voter can strategically cast the ballot with the avocado and the banana flipped, and then the input to the voting system is the bottom scenario. The output of the voting system changes to something other than coconut, which is a preferable outcome for the voter. So we found a scenario, namely the top one, where a certain voter has the incentive to vote strategically. And this finishes the proof of the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem. To summarize, if you come up with any reasonable voting system, I can look at a Condorcet cycle scenario and tweak it a little bit to find a scenario where your voting system gives a certain voter the incentive to vote strategically. To be frank, we only proved a baby version of the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem here. The actual theorem uses the least restrictive definition of a reasonable voting system, for which the conclusion still holds. For details, check out the video description. If you've heard about a theorem about voting systems before, it was probably not the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem, but rather Arrow's theorem. So let me tell you a bit about it and how the two are related. Arrow's theorem talks about more general voting systems that not only elect the winner, but rank all candidates from best to worst. One property that we would like these systems to have is the so-called independence of irrelevant alternatives. Here's what it says. Look at how the voting system orders any two candidates in some scenario. For example, here it decides that the avocado is above the banana. This decision should not depend on whatever the voter's opinion on the coconut is. In other words, in all these situations where we're changing opinions on the coconut, the relative position of the avocado and the banana has to stay the same in the final order. In this example, the coconut is the irrelevant alternative, of which the other two fruits are independent. Unfortunately, Arrow's theorem says that no reasonable voting system has this property. We often like to think that the important mathematical theorems are the complicated or deep ones, like Fermat's last theorem or P versus NP. But Arrow and Gibbard-Satterthwaite are good examples showing that this isn't always the case. For me, the biggest insight of these voting theorems is simply noticing that there is something to prove. Strategic voting isn't just a sociological fact, but it's a fundamental flaw of every voting system, and so is the lack of independence of irrelevant alternatives. Or is it? It turns out that the full story is more complicated. To understand why, let's look at one popular voting system called approval voting. This is an extremely simple voting system where every voter can give a vote to as many candidates as they want. Then we sum up the votes and order the candidates by how many votes they got. For example, if we order the videos of your favorite YouTube channel by the number of likes, that's basically approval voting, with the addition of negative votes. The way we order movies by their average rating is also similar to approval voting. But notice that approval voting and its variants don't fit into our definition of a voting system. In our definition, the voting system only receives as input the voters' rankings of the candidates. And that's not enough for approval voting. Even if I tell you how I would rank these videos, you still don't know whether I'd give a like just to the first one, the first two of them, or even dislike all of them. So our proofs of Arrow and Gibbard-Satterthwaite don't apply directly to these types of voting systems. And actually, Arrow's theorem cannot hold here, because approval voting does satisfy the independence of irrelevant alternatives. If I tell you that this video got 35,000 likes and this video got 5,000 likes, you know that in the final ranking, the first one will be above the second one, regardless of how many likes the other videos got. so Arrow's theorem may not be as fundamental as it seemed. However, even the approval voting system sometimes does incentivize strategic voting. For example, if you really want this to become our most liked video, you should first give it a like and subscribe. But then you should also dislike all other videos, regardless of your opinion of them. You can, in fact, generalize the Gibbard-Satterthwaite theorem to apply to pretty much any voting system, so unfortunately, in one way or another, strategic voting will always be with us. But how big of a problem is strategic voting, actually? First of all, there are many situations where strategic voting is not necessarily the main concern. For example, if you want to order thousands of entries to a math exposition contest, a bigger issue is probably how well your voting system scales with the number of candidates. But even in political elections, it's good to remember what Kenneth Arrow said about his own theorem. Most systems are not going to work badly all of the time. All I proved is that all can work badly at times. And indeed, some systems actually work pretty well most of the time. Some time back, a small group of voting theorists ranked the voting systems on how good they are for political elections, and approval voting actually ended up on top. And if you're wondering what voting system they used to conduct this vote, it was, tellingly, approval voting itself. In any case, just based on the number of votes for each option, you can see that there are some good voting systems, like approval voting. Another very popular one is the alternative vote, aka instant runoff. And then there are some decent voting systems, like the two-round system, a lot of mediocre ones, and then at the very bottom, with zero approval votes, we see plurality voting, a system with some pretty obvious flaws related to strategic voting. A system that's, by the way, used for elections in all these countries. So, dear monkeys, the short answer is that voting is complicated. But as a practical choice, I would recommend you to use... Hold on a second, I have an idea. How about making the vote randomized? It'll work like this. Every monkey writes only their most preferred candidate on the ballot, then I collect the ballots and elect the winner by shuffling them and choosing a random one. Strategic voting doesn't help in this system, and the more monkeys vote for a candidate, the more likely the candidate is to be elected. Okay, and the winner is... Banana! A few monkeys were quite happy.
Yay!
But the rest of them...
Hey, you didn't shuffle them enough, redo it. No, you shuffled way too much. This was supposed to be a random fruit, not banana. Stolen elections.
I had to leave the island pretty quickly after that. Rumor has it that the monkeys are still out there arguing, but this time about which voting system is the best one. If you enjoy our videos, consider supporting us by joining our Patreon or simply subscribing. See you next time!